Hi, this is Gary with MACMOST.com. Today, let me show you how to properly use header and footer rows and columns in Mac Numbers. MACMOST is brought to you thanks to a great group of more than 800 supporters. Go to MACMOST.com/Patreon. There, you could read more about the Patreon campaign, join us, and get exclusive content and course discounts. So when you create a new table in Numbers, usually you get one that looks like this. And you can see that you have these gray cells at the top and on the left. This is a header row and this is a header column. The cells there are a little bit different than the ones you see here in the body of the table. There are several different things that make the cells in header rows and columns different, and it's important to understand this difference to get the most out of Numbers. So for instance, here we have a table and I've named it class. And I have a header row here and a header column. Now the contents of the header row seem pretty simple to understand. They're simply the headings for each column. This column contains names, so the heading is name. This column contains grades. This column contains number of absences. And this is notes. So each one is basically a title for the column. The header column here contains student IDs. And each cell has a value in it. Now when possible, you should make the things in the header column unique IDs. So think of every row as a record in a database. And what's in the header column is the unique identifier for that row. So a name, for instance, may do in some cases, but since lots of people have the same names, if your table is big enough, you're going to have duplicates in the header column. So it's better to use something like maybe an ID number. The same thing, say, if you had a table of expenses, you may be tempted to put the date in the first column in the header column, but often you're going to have multiple expenses on the same day, so that's not a unique identifier. Something like a transaction ID or a check number would make for a unique identifier. In this case, we have student IDs. So far, this just looks like it's an organizational thing. I've neatly organized this table using a header row and a header column, but there are some ways in which the values in these cells behave a little differently. For instance, if I go to this table here and I want to simply refer to a cell in the other table, I'll use equals to enter a formula, and then I'll simply refer to this cell. Now, this cell is C5. So you may think when I click here to refer to it, I would get C5. But in fact, what I get is grade S640. Grade is the value in the header row, and S640 is the student ID from the header column. Now, I can actually type C5, but of course, since it's in a different table, I'm going to want to type class, the name of the table, then two colons, and then I can do C5. And you can see it will then convert to show me grade S640. Or I can simply type the reference using the header values. So if I type grade S640, you can see how it figures out that it's from the table class without me having to enter that. And now you can see it simplifies it, knowing that there is no other table with a grade column and an S640 row. So the proper use of header cells allows you to get away from using references like C5 and instead use things that make sense. Let's look at another example here. Here I have a driving log. It has dates, and for each date the number of miles that were driven and the amount of gasoline purchased. So when I refer to a cell here, I can click on, say, the number of miles driven on February 4th, and you could see the reference is miles and then the date. And you can see I could just type that. I'll hit equals here and then do miles and then 2/5, and you can see it actually even auto completes. So I can just hit return and you see it fills that in, and you can see another return then completes that entry, and now I have a reference to that cell without having to figure out that this was in fact B6. Not only that, it works in functions as well. So if I wanted to get the sum of all miles driven, I could do sum parentheses, and if I click on the letter of the column here, it actually fills in miles, not B. So it takes the name from the header cell. And now I can clearly see that this is the sum of miles. So what else do header cells do? Well, let's extend this table so it's longer than the screen. So now you can see here I have a lot of rows. Now you would think if I would scroll off the screen, it might be hard to remember what the column names are. But in fact, the header row will stay there. So as I scroll, you could see the header row freezes. The same thing actually happens with the header column here. So let's say I were to add a few more cells there, And you can see I can scroll over and you can see the header column stays steady. Now this is actually a setting. If I go to Format Table, you can see under Headers and Footer, I can click here and there's Freeze Header Columns. I can also go to Table and you can see Freeze Header Rows, Freeze Header Columns. And you could turn those off. And now you can see the whole table scrolls up so you lose those header rows. This also works for printing. So if I go to Print, one of the options I have here is Repeat Table Headers. So now when I look here, I've got page 1 and I see on page 2 it actually repeats the headers there. And it would do the same thing for the columns if this is extended horizontally across pages. So another important aspect of a header cell is it doesn't count when you actually try to perform calculations on it. So it looked perfectly natural before when I did a sum of this column here and it gave me a sum of all these numbers. It's not going to include this header cell here, miles, because why would it? Even if it included it, that's not a number. But what if I were to use average instead and then use this column? The question is it going to compute the average of these cells based on the fact that there are 9 of them or 10 including this cell here in the header? And the answer is that it won't include the header cell. So header cells are not included when you use functions on an entire column. Now what about footer cells? A footer cell is like a header cell except it appears at the bottom. So to add one here, we don't want to just go over here and add a footer cell like that. It'll turn the last row into a footer, which isn't what we want. The same thing if you were to go to table and then footer rows and set it to 1. Instead, what we want to do is add an extra row. So it's a blank row there. And then we can use either option to add a footer row. So let's add one there. Notice that the footer row does not continue the header column. The header column there is empty. This is not meant to be an individual record like the other rows. This is meant to be some sort of summary of what's found in the table. So you typically would put something like sum and then select this column here. And you could see it identifies it as miles. And then you get the sum here. Note that it's only counting the cells in the body. It's not counting the header cell and it's not counting the footer cell itself, else it would be doubling itself. Now another thing about footer rows is they always stay at the bottom. So if I select this cell here and I hit return to add another row, notice it adds another row and pushes the footer row down. Now I can have multiple headers and multiple footers. When I want to add another header, what I would do is select the table and then I could use this menu there, or I can go to table, header rows, and go to 2. And this will extend to the next row, the header. So if I really want to add one after already having some data, I want to add row above, or I can simply use the add header row above, and that'll both add a new row and make it a header row. Now when you have multiple header rows, things get a little complicated. It won't count any of these cells when you do sums or averages or anything like that, but it will take the name from the lowest header cell. So if I were to add some information here, like another word, then refer to a cell, you can see it takes the lowest word there. Header rows are not a good place to say put a sum like that. It works, but then the reference takes this value. You can see it says 680 instead of miles. So if you want to do multiple calculations on a row, it's best to do those in the footer. I can click here and add a footer row below like that and add another footer row, and then maybe here is the average of what's in the body for this column. And I could use the cells here in the first column as labels. So this could be sum and this could be average. So I hope that gives you a little bit of insight in how to best use header rows, header columns, and footer rows in your next numbers project. I publish new tutorials every weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out. Then hit the little bell icon to get notifications for each new tutorial.